What's the dealio? Amazin BLSN podcast. Hello, everybody, and how you doing? I am Lee Bishop. I am the host with the utmost respect for you guys. This podcast, I'm interviewing Earl F. Smith, a close friend of mine I've known for years, hard worker, single father, producer, writer, sometimes even actor. A true inspiration when it comes to music and just plain old living. Thank you for listening. Enjoy the talk. Enjoy the music. Amazin BLSN.
Amazin BLSN.
We'll probably start from now.
Okay, starting now.
Welcome to the Amazin BLSN podcast. My name is Lee Bishop. Thanks for coming out tonight, or coming out in the morning or afternoon, or wherever you are, in your beds, in your pajamas, or at work, or laying down with your significant other and touching each other and listening to the podcast and say, I'm bored as I listen to something. I have my favorite person in the world, Earl the Pearl Smith. Earl, what you want to call yourself?
I've been branding myself with Earl F. Smith. You know, there's a lot of Earl Smiths, but when you put the F, there's when you Google the with the F in there.
Earl, do you know why you're here?
No.
Because you're amazing.
Well, thank you.
I'm gonna tell you why you're amazing.
Okay.
Know you for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen you go through a lot of trials and tribulations.
Well,
you're probably the biggest hustler I know.
I don't see myself as a hustler.
I see you as a hustler, my friend.
Hard worker, I will say that.
That's a hustler, my friend.
I don't want to say that. A lot of trials and tribulations. I do have a story.
You have a fantastic story.
Thank you.
Known you for a while. I think you're a great producer, a great father, and a pretty cool friend, man.
Thank you.
And I appreciate you coming out in my little podcast.
Hey, nothing's little to me in this regard. Podcast, and I'm here. I mean,
physically, I'm little.
Oh, I see. You're funny.
So, man, let's. I like this opportunity because I get to talk with my friends about like their background and stuff, and I want to touch on the music.
Okay.
With you,
okay.
Since that's.
I'm an open book. Ask me whatever you like.
Let's do this though. Let's archive this though.
Okay.
Let's do this for shits and giggles.
Okay.
How did we meet?
Well, I met John. I had moved to Sacramento for a short period.
Sacramento, California.
I wanted to take a break from the music industry.
From that SoCal life.
Not necessarily the Southern California life, but specifically the music industry. I've been working full-time in the music industry, and I wanted to take a break from that and patch up some things with my family. So I went to be close to my family, Sacramento, which my mom is up there. I met John at the record store, and which is known as DJ Rock Bottom. And you were, months after I had met him and we became friends, you were at his house. And basically, in a sense, you were kind of interviewing me, questioning me, and I remember my response.
I was interrogating.
I guess you could put interrogating. And I said, wait a minute. And I was answering your question. I'm like, who the fuck are you?
This is correct.
Yeah. But yeah, I had a lot of fun in SAC. I walked away from SAC, came back to LA after getting back into it, and both you and John, you're two strong friends that I took away from that experience. And still friends today.
Let's get on the music, bro.
Okay.
Why music? When did you get the music bug?
I think it came from birth, really. And I say that when I was young meaning like 3,
very young.
My uncle told me, I don't know. He later told me when I was about 3 years old, my grandfather was a pastor. He had a church in Santa Ana. And so after the service, I would always wander on stage and I would go from instrument to instrument to instrument. Now, I have no recollection of that. But, you know, and then my grandmother, she was a piano player. My great aunts, they were a singing group. And then on my grandfather's side, my mom's dad, my uncle, so his brother, he was a music professor. So, like, you know, I had a lot of influences as a kid. But I would say that it really started when I was, that this was something I wanted to pursue. It was about when I was 15. I had this melody that was stuck in my head, and it was toying with me for a few months. And once I was able to sit down at a piano, so I had piano lessons when I was 9, and I had already been rapping and doing something. But once I was able to get that melody out,
yep,
it was a huge release for me.
Yeah.
And then that's when it really, my journey of music discovery. So my music career and what I do, it's a pathway for me. And I think I pinpoint to that point is where I enter into a level of consciousness of that release in music and what it did to me emotionally and internally. And I began to really seek all that music had to offer.
Did you go to class for that? For keys?
When I was 9, I had private piano lessons for about a year and a half. So at this time, no, I had not taken any classes. The following year, I started choir. But at that moment, I began to just figure out playing on my own. I don't want to say I'm self-taught, because I've had a lot of music training. But at this point, at that point in my life, I had a year and a half of piano lessons.
Well, I say that to say, because you took a class for conducting, as opposed to going piano. You know, taking a class for a specific instrument, you took a class for conducting.
Well, it's not that just conducting. I mean, I studied music in college. I have a bachelor's degree in music composition with an area of commercial media writing, which is film scoring and songwriting. And the requirements to get that degree was two different levels of conducting, choir and instrumental conducting. So, but that was later. That was in college. After that experience, I wandered into the music room at my high school, Anaheim High School. And there was a new teacher, Mr. Gibbs. He was an old teacher, but he had come back. And he heard me playing piano, and then he asked if I could sing. So he basically put me on a little audition that I didn't wear. And then he invited me to join the choir. And then I started then. And later, Mr. Gibbs gave me some vocal lessons. So I got 3 years of music in high school before I went over into college.
Can somebody who can't sing, if they had vocal lessons, can sing after vocal lessons?
Well,
or if you either have it or you don't.
So the way I'll answer that is there are some people who are tone deaf.
Right.
That's a problem. That's a problem. But there's a lot of people who claim to be tone deaf and really aren't. We talk in pitches. So if someone's like, you know, talking into a microphone and we take that, record that audio signal and we run it through some software, you'll see that the pitches, they're actually. So with that, so person has an ear. It's not tone deaf, and that's how you define it in that regard. And then the voice is a muscle. So when you ask someone, can they run? Well, a track runner usually runs fast because of their training. There's some talent there, but also their training. So developing the vocal cords as a muscle, it can be developed. And a person who may have trouble holding pitch can learn to hold pitch. Now, there's the other difference of you have singers that have a magical tone.
Right.
And that tone, that natural tone, that's something that you can't, you either have it or you don't.
Right. Like a Whitney or a Monica. Like
right.
Like you just talk.
And they could be, you know, they're talking and could be, a person may not be hitting pitches, but their tone, what they were born with, the timbre of their voice has something unique to it that's attractive to the ear. So when there's a lot of artists that are out, there's a lot about the production quality, but it also starts with that tone. And there's a uniqueness to it that's attractive to the air, to the ear. That's when you know someone has something. And it takes a certain level of skill for a person to really recognize that through the rawness and then put that person on a path of development.
So I feel like you work with a lot of people, right?
Yeah, I work with quite a
famous,
few.
Not famous, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you tell somebody like they ain't got it or they do got it, or like if they ain't singing right, do you tell them to go to vocal training, or do you do vocal training? Like how do you break it down without being a dick?
One, I'm a listener. And what I mean by I'm a listener, I don't just listen to what person's saying. I'm also listen to their body. So as I'm talking to someone, I'm listening to them wholly.
Right.
And
that's deep.
Based on that, I choose the words that I say, that I'm saying, and answering the question. Just because someone, I don't think they have a level of talent to be something incredible, doesn't mean that what I think will determine their career. And there's so many different levels and there's so many different things a person can do. I think it would be fair for me to pass judgment on someone. I can...
Fair or unfair? You mean...
Yeah, it's unfair to sit there and say, I don't think you should do this, search for something right. else. Because if that person has a passion for it, there's so many different things. Because you could take someone who doesn't have a great timbre, and if they're studying composition and vocal harmonies and come up with something very unique and different in vocal arrangements, and their songs are built off those vocal arrangements, well, the vocal arrangements can become something unique and something attractive. But it would take from their own pathway and their own discovery to get to that level, and how much work they're willing to put into it, and how much they believe in themselves. So if someone is really passionate about something and they want to do it, I say do it, no matter what someone says. I'll go to the level, say fuck it. You know, someone tells you no, that shouldn't be the reason. If you feel in your heart that that's something you want to do, you should do it. I think if, you know, you get to the end of your life and you're on your deathbed and you always had a desire to do something or try something and you never did it, you know, what an awful feeling.
I think the regret really is horrible.
What an awful feeling. But I would say, you know, for me, you know, I think at this point, a lot of people recognize my hard work, and my skill level. But, you know, I was one of those that I was discouraged not to do music. It's different now. Well, I think because the belief everyone has is that music is a far-off fantasy to make it a career. And when you're dealing with audio, you're dealing with sounds, there's so many different areas and so many different things a person can do in creating a career. And I think those people, a lot of times, that discourage, they have a certain level of ignorance, of not knowing or understanding the industry and how many different areas a person can go into to create a career, whether they have a raw natural talent or they don't.
So was this from family or from friends or from both? Like, where
from
you getting
both. From both. From? I got a lot of persecution from a lot of people growing up. Definitely from both family and friends.
To not do this.
Yeah, to not do it. I got laughed at about it. I mean, to go on and say, those same people, some of them I still contact, you know, because of Facebook. And,
right.
And, you know, their level of respect is on a different level now. There's a wow there, and glad I stuck with it, and I have their support now, and I have no judgment on it. You know, what I went through, I worked hard. It made me work hard. I'm a hard worker.
This is facts.
And I don't take no for an answer. And and based on that, I feel blessed that God has blessed me with some of the skills and talents that I have. But a lot of it's based on my hard work.
There's a level of made it, didn't make it. I know, like, I feel like a lot of people who didn't make it become either family men or record agents or something. You know what I mean? Do you feel like, are you trying to make it, quote unquote? Do you like where you're at? How far do you want to, you know, go with this? I know you just, well, personally with me, you discuss EPs and albums and, you know, working together and doing this and that. But, like, you know, you're not well known. You know what I'm saying? Like, how far do you wanna take this or keep going? Or, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is in your heart. You're always gonna do it, obviously. But if you don't make it, or you do make it, it don't matter, right?
Well,
like, you wanna live off of this.
Well,
I
have been living off of this. Past 10 years, I've been living purely off of music.
Right. Doing doing what? Sound engineering, all that shit.
Before I answer that question, let me say, a lot of people, you know, make this mention of making it. Some people tell me, Earl, you've made it. Well, some of those people that criticize me in school, they're like, wow, Earl, you've made it. And there's other people that say, when you make it. Or you made a mention, I'm not well known. I don't know. I in certain areas, in certain communities, I think I'm pretty well known. So, you know, with different people, where is that line of making it? I've say this to a lot of my clients. I was like, they're like, when I make, I say, you've already made it. You're in the industry. It's just where you are. And so for me, I'm a person of growth. There is no making it to me. I made it when I was 5 and I did my first show in front of 2,000 people. That was making me for that. That was making it. For the past 10 years, I've been purely living off of music. Now, what do? So I run my own studio. It's a high-end studio. So with that, I'm recording all different types of genres of music, and that's for me engineering and producing in my studio and others. I do a lot of sound design for films, indie films, as well as big releases. And sound design meaning cleaning up the audio from on-set recording and adding Foley and mixing. Also, in different genres, say for instance, thrillers or horrors, I'm using sound effects and other sound things to create a score to enhance the picture. I'm composing music for film and TV, and I'm also a songwriter. And currently, I've been a vocalist, and now I'm putting a band together, and I am going to be performing and recording as an artist and releasing my own material. So these are the things that I'm doing right now as far as in the music. I'm also building gear, high-end microphones, mic pre's, and compressors, and for certain individuals, they can hire me and I will build them certain gear. But I say for certain individuals, there's certain things that I look for before I could actually consider doing that for someone.
Custom-made gear.
Yeah. Or taking something they've had and modifying it. Most of my stuff has been modified. I modify everything, and it gives me a unique sound that separates me from others.
now some rhythm for you.
Thank you. Then one day, you get it. It's so good to you. But it's just like my girl. When she's around me, I just feel so good. So good. But right now, I just feel cold. So cold. Down to my bones. Cause you ain't no sunshine when she's
Brown sugar, babe. I guess high off of love. Don't know how to behave. Brown sugar, babe. Won't stop me now. Brown sugar, show me love, babe.
Amazin BLSN Podcast.
What are your thoughts on the industry, the music industry, in Los Angeles?
The music industry, it's exciting. I always consider the past, but I'm also always looking towards the future. And right now, we're on a new cusp because you have Netflix who's buying content. You have Amazon who's buying content.
I love Amazon.
Now you have Facebook buying content. So, you know, these are companies that have a lot of money that are buying content. So it leaves an open field for a lot of different, for people, independent filmmakers who are making short films or making features, composers. You know, all this content, they need music for that. With that, you have a lot of indie filmmakers who need music in their film, but doesn't understand fully what a composer does, to where a composer scoring music to their picture hitting events. They don't understand that, so they're looking for songs. So this opens up for a lot of songwriters. For with technology the way it is, There's an open field where people are buying gear. They may not have the knowledge of what to actually use, but they're at least taking a step forward and they're buying gear and trying to fulfill their own passions in creating content. So within that, technology now is allowing people to make really good quality at home without a lot of money.
Facts.
Yeah, so depending on how much work and how much a person is willing to be educated in the technology and in their craft, in my opinion, depends on how good their content is. But it opens the field up for people to have excellent content. And we're no longer, in my eyes, the industry is no longer these few people who have been the gatekeepers.
Yep.
And people being able to release something.
Yep.
And so for myself, I was exposed to, you know, major labels early on, and I decided to go a path where I put my, where I was not in a position where I had a person stamping me and controlling me and controlling my creativity. So in this way I can be free and to say what I want to say, free to be influenced the way I wanted to be influenced. And now the way the industry is, there's such a direct connect between the creator and the listener or the consumer. You don't need the gatekeepers.
Nope.
And there's a lot of power in that.
Yep.
And so for me, where the industry is now, it's exciting. Every day I'm just more excited to create more and more material. And
I think I like the fact that you don't gotta be in Los Angeles to be noticed, I guess. Because you could be on YouTube. What other platforms are there?
There's SoundCloud.
Vimeo, SoundCloud, MixCloud. I'm on MixCloud. Like, you ain't got to come to LA to make noise. You know, if somebody's gonna find you, you know, I found a cat on MixCloud. Some white cat who's makes he went back to the boom bap beats and it's fantastic. And then he ain't out here. And he's getting a lot of notoriety. It's slowly climbing, but I think he's gonna get there just off of the beats, man. And that's what I like. And when you say gatekeepers, I fully support this new movement, because I can just see some fat guy just saying, "No, I don't want that. He ain't gonna get no money from me." Blah blah blah. Like, we don't need that now.
Yeah.
All these indie people, you know, Mac Miller, who else? Chance. Like, I just hope they see that and getting scared, you know what I'm saying? Because, like, now we're getting more quality music. Now, it does leave room for the boo-boo, and that's a problem. Because I feel like there's more boo-boo than there is better content, but, like, whatever.
That's true. You know, yes, there's...
It's like there's like people who can't sing. Nobody's going to tell them they can't sing because maybe they got a hit because the song's so retarded, but it's catchy. And it's like, you know this guy can't sing, but nobody in the studio, they don't know any better because of education or lack of education, of sound quality, whatever. And it's just not, I hate that. And that's where I feel like the label would come in. And media training. These cats don't got media training, and they can't do a good interview. You know what I'm saying? Whereas before, the label would be like, we'll give you media training so you can talk to the public and not sound like a dumbass. and that's lost now because the labels are dying. That's the only thing I hate. That's it.
Well, I try not to pass judgment. I try really hard not to do that. And, you know, going, well, I'm not saying that you are, but I'm just saying for myself. But going back to what I was saying earlier about someone having a uniqueness to their voice. And because there's been some songs that I've heard. I mean, they just recorded awful. But it was just a dope song. I mean, the song was just incredible, and nothing mattered. It didn't matter that there was some of the vocal pitches were out of tune. Mm. It's nothing mattered. It was just really incredible song, and just the way it sonically sounded. It didn't sound the best, but there was just certain uniqueness to it that was just incredible. And I think about it. So, you know, if I went back and I had signed this individual, and I would go reproduce the song, you know, on great mics and great mic pre's and working in Pro Tools, and I don't know if the song would still have its magic.
I feel that.
And so
I said, like MF Doom, when MF Doom first came out, there was no mastering. The songs were, felt like they were like cleverly put together, but not the best equipment, and it made for a good album. Like if it was fixed and mastered, like it wouldn't sound the same. We wanted that grittiness. Right. We love that grittiness.
Right.
But then then you have like producers like Teddy Riley, and Teddy Riley will tell you like he can't sing, but he knows his notes. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, you know, and he'll, and Pharrell too. I don't think Pharrell can sing either, but he gets a pass for some reason. But hit song like Frontin', you're not gonna front on Frontin'. It's a good song.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. So it's a fine line to me.
Well, it's, you know, it's art.
Some of it is.
And you know, there's a lot of different types of art, and I know what I would do and what I wouldn't do, but that's me. Yes, I think the industry, when we look at as the whole, it is what would be the right word, it's just engulfed with a lot of material, and a lot of material that's not great, and which makes it harder for people to find good content, good strong content. But you know, it has its challenges. And, you know, that's where marketing comes in. And there's other people that, you know, didn't necessarily, their creativity, I feel, needs some work. But there can be genius in marketing. And in that regard, a lot of people know them. They may be selling a lot. So, you know, the best basketball player is not in the NBA. I strongly believe that. And as well as the best singer, the best songwriter, may not be popular, but it's in my opinion, it's a complete package for someone to be successful in the music business, no matter where they are, whether they're independent or they're in a major label. It's a complete package. People can climb up to the top and fizzle out real quick. Also, you know, climb up quick and fizzle out quick. Do nice. Interviews and say some awful things that really they may not necessarily mean, but just getting caught up in the emotion and just the immaturity of it.
Facts.
And then they X themselves out and all their fans leave. But, you know, it's a matter of the, you know, people at this point, I think, have more control over their creativity. And for me, that's exciting. So whether a person wants to do some research or work on their maturity level and presenting themselves for a longevity career, you know, it really rides on that individual. And, you know, no one's perfect. We all make mistakes. And sometimes those mistakes can be great marketing tools. You know, we look at Kanye West, you know, when he got up there and says Bush doesn't like black people. Facts. You know, he took a hit on that. And then when he got up there,
he took a hit on, like, not in the black community. He didn't.
Well, you know, and I mean, at the time, we look at who was buying records. You know, a lot of people, you know, for the longest time, use white women buy records. Now it's different, you know, but also too, when Kanye, you know, got up there and did that thing on Beyonce's video and with Taylor Swift, you know, he took a hit on that too, but
that was bigger.
Yeah. That Taylor, I mean, that did big for her career. So, you know, you never know if some things are planned or not. Some things are marketing. That's one thing is, you know, I look at Madonna. Madonna is, you know, here are her early stuff. She's not the best vocalist, but she has some great songs. The production is killer.
Yep.
And she's an amazing marketer.
Yeah.
Amazing. And
she takes fantastic photos.
Yeah. And so, you know, it still comes back to, it's up to the individual. You know, the person's art, you can turn it into a business. And you can have some people that don't realize that. And they're just doing what they're doing. And they make some mistakes and rise quick and fall quick. And there's others that will run it like a business and take their product or their creativity and be careful with it. It's up to the individual, really. And that's what's exciting to me about today's industry and the tools that are out and how we're able to reach the consumer now versus, you know, 30 years ago, 50 years ago, if you look at the models, or things are different now. And we have a lot of access to a lot of information.
Explain to me, being an indie artist, getting paid correctly for your quality of work. You know what I mean? Like, personally, you've talked to me about people not paying or not paying enough because they feel like they don't understand, don't get the quality of the work and what you put into it, right? But explain to people, like, you just can't ride shit for free. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
I know what you mean.
And I feel like you're the perfect person to explain that, because you've called me many times and vented to me, and I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. But I just find it weird, like, people don't get that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it took me a while to get that too, because I'd be like, you know, you gotta do things for free, blah blah blah. But there comes a time where, like, I feel like if you keep doing that, then those people will keep getting away with not paying other people the proper payment. Let me give you an example.
Okay.
Of me being a dick. So I wanted to do a video with a dancer, right? Mm-hmm. And I went to the studio and I met a dancer, and I got her information. Not that I wanted her to be in it, but I thought this was my attempt at networking, mm-hmm. and getting out of my box. Mm-hmm. And I emailed her and asked for her for ideas, and she mentioned the payment, and I said, I didn't say free, but I said something like stupid, like 20 or 50 bucks. And she didn't go off on me, but she did put me in check, right? Kind of set me in a different path to think, rethink what I was, what I should be paying. It's the quality, the time, and all that goes into it. And it made sense to me reading that. So I learned my lesson. In that, just by that email, and by the conversations with you. But explain to me.
Yeah,
the quality and content of your services, and why you should get paid the way you do. Because sometimes, one time you said some outlandish price, and I was like, man, that's crazy. I wouldn't pay that, but I get it. I get it now, but I wouldn't pay that. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I mean, that's where, you know, this area, I think is a strong area for, you know, anybody trying to pursue a career in the entertainment industry, no matter what area, whether it's video, audio, dancing, no matter what area, painting, there's a certain level when you know your craft and you get to a certain level where you begin to attract people. You become good enough to where people are being attracted. To have the skill to be able to educate your potential customer or your potential client is very valuable. That I believe that is the one skill that has made and break me. Or make and break a person, not necessarily me. I think that's the one skill that has made me, because I'm good at what I do.
Facts.
Not to sound arrogant.
That's okay.
Because I try to be as humble as I can be.
Very humble.
Thank you,
Kendrick Lamar.
But for me, the way I'm able to pay my bills. And doing what I love to do, has been educating my potential clients of why things are priced the way they are, and doing that to a level that is sensitive, and is non-aggressive. Because when a person understands why a price is put at its price, and how much time it takes, and how much money the equipment cost, and how much effort was put in to obtain the equipment to give them the level of quality that they want. Because in the end, people want quality. They want to be presented. They want to present whatever they're working on as it being professional. That it's not boo-boo. That people will take them serious. And so when people are coming to me for a service, they're wanting something that will present them to the world a level that is attractive. And so based on that level that they want to be presented, it's how I price things. And it's basically priced based on how much time I put into it, or how much time is needed to be put into it. Now, I don't do half-ass work. I don't do boo-boo work. And I have had some people say, okay, just throw something together. I don't just do that. I will not cheat my listeners. I will not take money, because what I do not do it for money. And it shows. I'm very passionate. I love what I do. I love giving quality. I put my all into everything. Doesn't mean that it's going to require a super amount of time, but what I do it professionally. And so people who come to me, that's what they're looking for. And based on that is how it's priced. So for me, the way I've done it is by educating the potential client. And I think that's with you, Bishop, is, you know, some of the conversations we've had, or I've had some, you know, frustrating clients. But there's this level of radio. I think it started with radio. You know, you could turn on the radio and you don't have to pay anything to listen to music, to listen. So
now it's Spotify and
Pandora and some of these others, but people don't always realize those commercials. People are influenced by those commercials, and those commercials get people interested in the products. So in the level of music and audio is attracting listeners for sales. And so when a person begins to understand that, so say for instance, I have a person come up to me and they want me to score their independent film and they don't have money. Not to say that I will just be like, no, get out of here. I say, well, what do you have? And they look at me funny like, well, yeah, I say, well, you said you have no money. Well, what's your skills? And I give an example. I scored a film called Average American. And the writer-director, I've known since I was a kid. And this was a woman I knew and I trusted. She had a very kind heart and I wanted to help her. But I couldn't work for free. As a single parent, I just couldn't work for free. So with her, I found out what she was willing to do. And so I bartered with her on babysitting.
I remember that one.
Yeah. So I calculated what it would cost to score her film. I also did the sound design for her film. I calculated what it would cost based on time. And then we put a value to an hourly rate on babysitting. And we made it comparable. And we did a contract on that. And that worked very well for me because I wanted to go out on the weekend. I had other business to conduct. And I needed a babysitter. And so that was great. So when a person begins to understand that, just like in the times before, you know, the world was dealing with cash, people bartered. And so it's just that now people just have to understand the value. And I think it's up to you as an artist or as a creator of content to get your potential client to understand why your product has been placed with a certain value. And so for me, it's me educating my client. Even in my albums and music that I'm working on, a level of that in my songwriting, I'm educating my potential listener. For instance, I'm working on a book called Beating the Biased, How This Father Got Full Custody. And I'm writing this book as a story, my thoughts, why I did what I did, why I chose to make the decisions I made. But really in that, I'm educating, saying, hey, you want to be in your child's life? The court system may have a certain level of bias, but if you know how to maneuver in it, you too can have your desire. And for me, my strongest desire was to spend as much time as I could with my child and make sure my child is safe and healthy, because my child is a reflection of me.
Nice.
And that was a strong passion of mine. So, but in my book, which is an intellectual property, it's content, there's a certain level in the story I'm educating. And I'm helping, you know, a big part of that's me wanting to help, through what I have to offer the world.
Okay. you are leaving. Explain to me the benefits of moving back to Sacramento. I'm excited for you. And I'm excited for you because you've been wanting to do this for a while. And now that it's happening, I'm just happy for you because you seem more happier, and you showed me the space, the ugly space. Mm-hmm. I saw pictures of it, and I can't wait till it gets cleaned up.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, man, share with me, goddamn.
Well, I don't want to say I want to put it as I'm leaving because I'm not leaving. I'm relocating my child is really what I'm doing. But all my work that I'm doing in LA will still remain. I'm from Orange County, which is, you know, according to Sacramento, is, you know, like Elk Grove. Is Elk Grove not a part of Sacramento? Or is Orange County not a part of LA? I think it kind of is. I mean, me being from Orange County and everyone I know from Orange County would argue against that.
But I think for me at this level, I'm starting to realize, you know, Orange County really is LA, even though it's not technically LA County. But I have a lot of strong ties here. So in a sense, I want to say I've grown up here. But my plan is really to go back and forth. And being close to my family to help with my child frees me up to travel. I have a lot of ideas. I have a lot of material that I've been working on for the past 10, 15 years that I want to release. So I'm moving in my life into a place of completion. And so I'm removing chaos, a chaotic atmosphere, and removing certain pressures so I can internalize into a space, into this building that I will be in South Sacramento, where I will begin to complete a lot of material. I have quite a few albums that are almost done. I need to mix them. I need to add little elements to them. So I plan to do that there, while my family is helping out with my child. So I will be there completing these projects, but that doesn't mean I'm not here. If not every week, it would be every other week, at least 3-4 days out of the week, I will be here in LA, just going back and forth. I mean, this week alone, well, let me say, the past 10 days, I've gone to Sacramento and back 4 times.
You don't think you're going to get tired of that? Well, are you driving?
I'm driving. Flying is not is nothing. It's 45 minutes away.
True. But that's also money.
Yeah, it's not that much. $80.
To fly?
Yeah, I found round trip tickets for $82.
On what?
Southwest. So, you know, plan it right. But you know, I don't want to pin it that that's what it is. I'm riding the wave of life. And what's most important is the level of completion. I want to have my first draft, my first book, the first draft done by the first of the year. I have 3 other records I want to have done by October. I'm also working on a tutorial on how to clean up audio for indie films. I want to have that done by the first of the year. These projects are projects that I've been very passionate about, and I have not been able to do since I've been here. Just the hustle bustle of dealing with all the work that I'm working on. Currently, the biggest project I'm working on is Space Command. It's with Mark Zickery and Lane Zickery. It's basically Twilight Zone. I'm sound designer on this. You can check out some of their work, spacecommand.com. So, you know, that's happening here in LA. We have a meeting every week. So I plan to be at that meeting, if not every week, every other week. My daughter will be seeing her mother, and some of those visits are in Los Angeles every month. So I'll be down here for that. So it's kind of hard for me to really focus around I'm leaving. I don't think I'm leaving. I am relocating my child because my child will be going to school in Folsom. I am real excited about the community in the Sacramento County. There's a lot of talent there. And I want to discover some of that talent. I want to tap in with it. I want to work with some people. Folsom has a very strong vocal jazz community. You know, this is something I want to tap into. I have some friends that are in the Bay Area. This will enable me to work with them more. I'm planning to go to the Philippines in October. I'm connecting with some talent there. the first of the next year, I'm planning to go to Japan. You know, these are things that have been, would be, you know, have been really hard to try to put in into play with me 100% in Los Angeles. Just, you know, going 2 weeks to the Philippines, you know, I need someone to watch my daughter that I can trust. But so relocating my daughter to Folsom, being by my mother, you know, enables me where I can do that and not worry. As let us long, come down to LA and work for a week really hard and be able to give things the time that they need, and give it the full attention of the skills that I have to offer on these projects. So in this regard, for me, it's a step up, and that's the excitement that you're hearing. Because I feel I have a lot to offer people, projects, and it's tough to balance it all. And I make choices. You know, I've made choices. I've been asked to work on Avatar under Aaron Martin. I turned that down because of the responsibility that I was that I'm dedicated to in raising my daughter. So with this type of help and relocating my daughter to Folsom enables me to step into a new realm. I also made this decision because I think it'll enable a stronger connection and visitation between my daughter and her mother. Looking at it from a psychological standpoint, sometimes people feel like they're leaving, so then it pulls a stronger connection to connect. And that relationship has been very broken. And so, you know, this is also in that situation, trying something new, trying something that could my daughter can benefit from. So I just have a hard time saying I'm leaving. I don't feel like I'm leaving at all. I think I'm actually more connecting this way than ever. And I'm real excited about it, especially some of this material that I'm going to be releasing. Just the production level, the writing, you know, I feel like a lot of my music comes from a different approach because I've chosen to be on the outside of dealing with the gatekeepers, where I have relationship with gatekeepers, but I'm not under their stamp. In this way, my influence is different, and I'm excited to share that and see what that will do to the consumer or any fan.
Earl, I'd like to thank you for coming on my podcast.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here.
Is there any social media you'd like to share with the audience?
Everything's under my name. I'm branding my name, Earl F. Smith. You can Google that. My Facebook is Earl F. Smith. My YouTube is Earl F. Smith. My SoundCloud is Earl F. Smith. My website is earlfsmith.com. Everything will lead you to these different links. But yeah.
Any last words?
Yeah, check, you know, look out for YouTube. I'm going to be reviewing different equipment, especially the microphones that I'm building. And from there, I welcome any questions, any criticism, any comments, and I'm going to be responding to those. Like I was mentioning earlier, you know, a lot of it's about information. And if people are hungry for that information, I want to be able to provide that. And these are some ways that, you know, start conversations, because it's all about conversations.
And I also feel like you're the perfect person for that, because, I mean, I've personally learned a lot from you. And I don't take that for granted. And you got a lot of stuff to share, bro. And yeah, I think the YouTube idea is like perfect. The book is makes sense. The music is just, I mean, can't wait for people to hear it. And yeah, man, I'm excited for
awesome.
You. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, brother. We out. Amazin BLSN. Lee Bishop, Earl F. Smith. I appreciate you, bro.
Appreciate you too.
All right. Thank you.
hey, you got through it. I hope you enjoyed it. That's my brother right there, Earl F. Smith, the creator. I would say good luck in his future endeavors, but he don't need it because it's going to happen. To see this man have all these ideas and all these creative juices going just puts fire underneath myself to get my shit going. Truly inspirational. I'm glad you stayed and listened. You can always hit me up at downtownera@gmail.com. Era is E-R-A. I've been your host, Lee Bishop. Hope you guys tune in once again on the next podcast. Amazin BLSN Podcast. We're not amazing without you. Thank you for listening.